Welcome to another inspiring message with Pastor Deborah Bell from Deo Gloria, South Africa, as she brings you a word from God.
Do you know that this morning? How many agree that the Word of God holds life?
Yes.
This Word is the inspired Word of God, and it brings life. Hebrews 4:12 tells us that it's sharper than any double-edged sword, and that it brings life, that it is alive, that it is active, because it is the inspiration of God. It is by God's Spirit that this book was written. Amen?
Yeah.
That doesn't mean that we take everything literally. We take everything in its context and its own dimension of the way it's been written and to whom it's been written. But at the same time, we understand that God's Word brings life. That's why the devil tries to stop you reading it, and that's why the devil stops you praying, because those two things are the things that are the fuel to keep a Christian going. Are you hearing me this morning?
Amen.
The most basic things that we think we've heard enough about are the things that Christians lack the most. And that is their prayer lives and reading of the Word.
Amen.
And I believe it's because there's such a struggle in the flesh of human beings against the Spirit. The Spirit and the flesh are always at war. Are you with me?
Yeah.
But God wants us to sow into the Spirit. Because as we sow into the flesh, we reap the rewards of the flesh. That's what I was saying earlier. Not the reward of the Spirit. Amen?
Amen.
And so let's just move forward. We're doing a series this morning, and this is part two, and it's called Going Viral with the Gospel. Everyone say, I'm going viral with the Gospel.
I'm going viral with the Gospel.
And if you aren't convinced yet, wait. If you hang around here a few more weeks, you will be going viral with the Gospel. Amen? And I don't want to do a whole lot of typical evangelism, preaching, or anything like that. All I want to do is give you the insight to our vision. Our vision is huge. We've had prophetic words that I can't even share with you because it's not the time or season. But I can tell you that they will come to pass, every one of them, as long as we continue to walk in the way of the Lord.
Amen.
And hopefully soon, as long as everyone else continues to walk in obedience to the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
But we're here by grace. And friends, I'm telling you, God is going to bring such provision. You know that 2013 is the year of provision?
Amen.
That's why we keep talking about our camels are coming, because camels bring provision. And there is a new move of God that is happening throughout the earth. It's not a fresh anointing, it's a new anointing. God gave it to me in September, and I am so glad and grateful when I see key words that we prophesy in this church coming to life by prophets that are global, renowned prophets, because we're so isolated as a church. And when we hear the global prophets speaking out these words, we know that we know that we know that our God is alive in this church. And God has times do you hear messages from preachers or on TV? You could be watching them or listening. And you hear messages time and time again about how important it is as a Christian to win souls for Christ.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
I think there are just so many messages. We hear it, sometimes it might irritate us, we hear it so much. Winning souls, how many souls have you won for Christ? But how many know that that message is not even preached enough? Because apparently only 2% of the church are winning souls. The global church. That's a scary figure. So what are we doing with our time for the Lord? How are we being salt and light? Turn with me quickly to Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5, verse 13. This wasn't originally what I wanted to start with, but let's read some words that are, let's read the red letter version. Let's read it together. Verse 13, chapter 5. I'm reading from the NLT. You are the salt of the earth. Tell your neighbor, you're the salt of the earth. Then tell your other neighbor, what if good salt has lost its flavor?
What if the salt has lost its flavor?
The word says, Jesus goes on to say, can you make it salty again? It will be thrown out and trampled underfoot as worthless. Now verse 14, you are the light of the world. Tell your neighbor, you are the light of the world. A city on a hilltop that cannot be hidden. Verse 15, no one lights a lamp and then puts it under a basket. Instead, a lamp is placed on a stand where it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your good deeds shine out for all to see, so that everyone will praise God, your heavenly parent.
Amen.
Friends, you know, it never ceases to amaze me how simple this whole illustration is when Jesus taught this. Think about this logically. You buy a beautiful, ornate lamp for your house. Tell me what the first thing is you're going to do with that lamp. You know where you're going to put it, right? You have a good idea. Not so?
Yeah.
No. You have a good idea. Most of you have a good idea. Most of the guys have a good idea. Okay? And then what do? You make sure that that lamp is in a position where it's going to give enough light and atmosphere to the room in which you put it.
Amen.
How many of you buy a lamp and then go and shove it under the bed, put it on and say, hey, listen, did you see the new lamp I bought? You don't do that. And this is the most simple illustration that Jesus gives us. Do you know how many Christians look like they are under the bed? There are more Christians that have lost their saltiness than there are those that are light. Pastor Todd put something on for us on our Day of Glory Facebook. We're going to look like light and taste like salt. Friends, the salt is the presence of God in your life. It is the glory of God in your life. It's the manifest presence in your life. Now friends, how many of you know, if the fire has been, if you've thrown water on the fire and you've put out the fire, there's no warmth. There's nothing to give. Friends, if you switch off the light, it's dark. If you hide the light, there's no light. You and I lose our saltiness when we lose the fire of God in our lives.
Amen.
When we stop hungering after God more than we hunger after earthly things.
Amen.
And friends, when we lose our saltiness, we are of no earthly good or heavenly good to God, to use. Because you and I will wear ourselves down, and we will certainly not minister or evangelize or win souls when we don't have the fire of God in our lives. Because we don't even have enough energy to sort out our own lives.
Yeah.
We're all busy, amen?
Yeah.
We have our own lives to worry about. We've got our own stuff. And this selfishness that prevails in our lives when the fire of God is not there is such a reality, even for Christians. We can come to church on a Sunday and still have hard hearts. We can come to church on a Sunday and get religious, but not have the glory of God on the Monday to the Friday or Saturday.
Yes.
And what God wants to do this morning is to ignite the fire in your lives so that you have not only a passion for Jesus, but that you have the power of God that begins to manifest in your life and touch you and move you and shake you so that you cannot help but share the gospel of Christ with others. And it goes further than that. It goes further than that. We are not just to win souls. We are not just to talk about Christ to people. We are not just to invite them to church. But the Bible goes further. The mandate in Matthew 28, which you all know so well, is to make disciples.
Yeah.
Who's going to make the disciples? Oh, well, that's your job, Pastor. Sure, okay, so how long does it take to spend with one person and lead them on a path for a year and be faithful in a covenant relationship with them, it takes a lot to disciple somebody. That's why God said, I'm using the whole church.
Amen.
It's not the pastor's job. It'll take forever. Jesus will come before that. Before I've got enough souls. That's why the activation of this new move of God is never about the pastor. It's about the whole body of Christ. It's about you and me. It's not a pastor that sits on some throne that can go, there with a scepter, there. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. You are called to lay hands on the sick. You are called to anoint people. You are called to lead people to the Lord. You are the ones that are called to be the salt and the light of the earth. You must taste salty and you must be full of light. To taste salty, you have to have the fire of God. You will not have any inclination or any desire to tell people about Christ in any kind of an energetic way that makes them desire more of God unless the fire of God is in you. Unless the glory of God is upon your life and you are so excited that your heart begins to beat when you see someone that you think might just be the one God wants you to talk to. Your mind and your spirit change focus completely into where God wants you to be. It doesn't matter what you're doing at work. It doesn't matter where you are. You can be eating somewhere and suddenly the Lord, the Spirit of God, you're so conscious of the Spirit and presence of God that no matter how carnal you are thinking, the Spirit of God, is you're so sensitive to the Spirit that the Lord just begins to speak to you in a whisper that you need to go over to that person and just bring, invite them to church because you can identify them.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen?
And I'm telling you, friends, God is up to something very big.
Yes.
We have no idea. I said to Pastor Emmy yesterday, it wouldn't surprise me if the space gets too small. But you know what? We might be crammed in here like sardines until the provision comes.
Amen.
So make sure you're obedient to the Lord with the provision. Amen?
Amen.
But I'm telling you, God is good and God is faithful and God wants us all to come to the knowledge of the glory of God in our lives. So many Christians live without the fire and without the glory. How can we survive? How can we move into the fullness of who God has called us to be without the fire, without the glory of God in our lives? Because friends, without that, there's no transformation. There's no change. There's no inward change. Enough radical change for me to be on fire and have the right focus. When I'm on fire for Christ, I have the right focus. Amen?
Amen.
Are you with me?
Yeah.
Friends, you know what? We were watching one of Pastor Andy's things. It's from his one of the pastors of Apostle Maldonado, and he said this. He said, the problem with the church is that there's no fire on the altar. And I believe that we've killed the fire. We've killed the fire because we've restricted God to everything that we want to do. And we've taken away that element of sacrifice that comes with being a Christian. It's about self and selfishness and my stuff and my spirit and my blessing. And it's not about that at all. It's about what we can do for the kingdom. It's about having a vision in our heart for God. It's about letting God turn you so upside down that you become like Paul on the road to Damascus. That when he was on that road, as he was busy going on the journey one way, all of a sudden Jesus appears to him and turns his life upside down. When he could see with his carnal eyes, he couldn't see spiritually. When his carnal eyes were blinded for those few days, he could see spiritually. And I think some of us need to ask the Lord to close our carnal eyes and to open our spiritual heart.
Yeah.
So that we can see what God has in store for us. Because friends, we can't live in 2013 the same way we did in 2012.
Yeah.
There is something new brewing. Let me tell you friends, the new church that God is raising up now, the generation of people that God is raising up now, this is not a church like you've seen before. It's an army. God is raising an army. Why an army? Because even as we stand on this land today, it is through prayer and petition that we have taken territory. People that don't believe in principalities and powers, I just want to tell you we're here today because we do.
Amen.
Because we don't believe in in the principalities and powers without believing in the one who is greater power, Jesus Christ. And we have prayed and we have had warfare and all sorts of things, because if you don't know it, there are things called territorial spirits that would hinder, and we cut off the giant's head. We make declarations in the spirit. We have prayed. We've had prayer meetings, early morning prayer meetings for months now, where our prayer teams have come and they've committed to pray. And we've been praying over this land. Nothing just happened. Yeah. It came through prayer and fasting and commitment to the vision of what God is doing. Because we all have a fire inside of us and we're believing for great things. The church is not going to look anything like it did. Amen. Friends, I'm telling you. And that's why the people that are religious, those that have a mindset where they're only prepared to limit God to what they can see, and anything out of those boundaries that looks too airy-fairy or too scary or too much of a freak out for them, they are the ones that are going to get up and leave. And those are not the people you want in your church anyway. You want people that are on fire for God. You want people that are working these in the kingdom. You want people that have a vision, that they know where they're going in Christ, and that they see the kingdom before they see anything else. Why? Because if my heart is in that place, I know that Matthew 6:33 comes after that. Yeah. That every other thing of the desire of my heart shall be fulfilled. Amen. It's not one thing God wants to withhold from you. But Jesus says, let our priorities start in 2013 the right way. Friends, every time we have an altar call, and this will be the first one here,
Amen.
There are many people that do not come up that know that they should be up. Now, I'm talking to you seriously. Don't do that this morning. If you know you're meant to be up here, but you've got control issues because you're worried about what you're going to look like, and if the Spirit of God touches you and you fall, well, then if people see my tummy or my belly or my nose hairs or whatever it is, it's time for us to say, you know what, it doesn't matter. God, if you can just turn me inside out, if you can just change my mind about where I am, if you can just touch me and transform me into who you want me to be, if your glory can just come upon me, I'll do whatever you want me to do. That's what we want. We want people that have the fire of God inside of them, that they are changed forever. Now just let me just add a note. Not everyone here is in the same place. So when I talk, just know you need to come from where you are. There's a different plumb line for everyone. Amen? So don't freak out if you're not in this place and you're thinking, oh wow, I can't be there. I feel you so close to me. Only move or breathe. Yes, Lord. Come on, friends, the Spirit is here.
I can feel your presence all around. I fall knees down to the ground.
You're the one.
Beginning to speak to some of your hearts so personally, both a combination of through the worship and even this word this morning. I haven't even started my word. Friends, think about this. When we sow in the wrong soil, when we sow the wrong seed in the wrong soil, for so many years, do you not think it's going to take time for us to turn and to change? Of course it is. But there comes a time where we just have to surrender and allow the quickening of the Holy Spirit to change the things that need to be changed, to open ourselves up to be vulnerable to God. To say, Lord, I can't go into 2013 the way I did in 2012. I can't wait until July and realize I'm in July and I was only in February. It felt like last month. And half the year is gone and nothing's changed in my life. You see, when you have a relationship with Holy Spirit, your life changes completely.
You cannot be the same. And so God doesn't only want us to have an encounter with the Holy Spirit this morning. It's more than that. God wants us to have an ongoing encounter with the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
So that our relationship is not with Jesus alone, but with the Holy Spirit. So that we are filled with the glory of God, because the Bible says prophetically that the glory of God is going to cover you as the water covers the seas. If that's the case, who's going to do it? God is going to use us. And if you don't come up this morning to this altar call for the fire, if you don't come up, you're going to miss out on beginning your year and positioning yourself and posturing yourself to be made ready for a fertile soil and a year of absolute promise from God. But you have to allow God to turn your heart around this morning. You have to be one that says, I cannot do this the same way I did it last year. I cannot do this this way. Amen?
Yeah.
I feel you so close to me, I can hardly breathe.
Holding on to some old things. There's some things, no matter how dear they are to you, that you have to let go and begin to trust God with them. There are some things, friends. And I'm telling you right now that the church that God is raising up are a people of power.
Yes.
A people of power. I am telling you, a people of power. You've got to believe me. When I say, don't believe me, believe the word. I don't know about you, but you know, if you put a little bit, just salt is a very powerful thing. You just put a little bit on your food, right? And you can taste it, especially if you don't normally eat salt. So no one says you have to kind of fall over, drop down, roll. I'm saying just allow a little bit of the saltiness to permeate your being. Let the Holy Spirit begin to move in your life. Some people cut God off out of their lives because they've had bad experiences in the church, especially in some of our communities. But I want to tell you this morning that God has a plan for your life, and you are not here by mistake this morning. There is not one person. There might be some of our people not here, but there is not one person that is in this place this morning by accident or mistake. Amen? Not one. Zechariah 8:11. But now I will not treat the remnant of my people as I treated them before, says the Lord. Read verse 12 with me. For I am planting seeds of peace and prosperity among you, and the grapevines will be heavy with fruit, and the earth will produce its crops, and the heavens will release dew. And this morning God is giving us the opportunity for the dew of heaven to fall. Friends, think about this. Even the dew, when it falls upon the plants, it brings forth food for them and sustenance. We need the dew of heaven. We need the water of life. We need the fire of the Holy Spirit in our lives more than ever. And if we're going to be hung up this morning about who's going to watch us and who's going to see front and our pride becomes bigger than our need for God, we're going to be in trouble. Seriously. Do you know what I'm saying? This morning, friends, it doesn't matter who's next to you, who's on the side of you, who's behind you, who's wherever. You are taking a stand this morning to say, Lord, I want to do whatever it takes to get close to you. I want a relationship with Holy Spirit and Jesus Christ. I want to be one of those that is a glory carrier for you this morning.
Amen.
I want to be one who brings the heavy fruit of the Holy Spirit into the midst of others. I want to be the one that produces a crop this morning. I want to be the one that can turn around a harvest for you, Lord, because your power is upon me and your anointing is upon me, and you have ordained me and anointed me to preach the good news.
Hallelujah.
And the Bible says, and then the heavens will release the dew, because the dew is that which makes the earth fruitful. And this morning the dew of heaven is going to fall upon you so that you may be fruitful.
Amen.
We may not want to multiply people anymore on this earth, but we have to multiply Christians. We have to multiply the children of God. We have to be a people that are bringing in a harvest. Now for some people that is the most boring thing they can hear. And I'm asking you to let God turn your heart around this morning. That you don't go into the new with the old on your back. That you come and you surrender everything, every anxiety, every struggle, every stress, every sickness, every disease, every whatever is growing on your body or in your spirit or wherever it is that it gets cut off today. That you cut off the giant's head and you allow the dew of heaven to fall upon you. Because you can't go viral with any gospel without the dew of heaven upon you. You can't go viral with a gospel when you don't even look like you're alive.
Jesus.
And then the word says, and once more I will cause the remnant of Judah and Israel to inherit their blessing. Friends, you are the inheritors of the blessing. The problem is we wonder why some get it and some don't. It's simply a case of surrender and sacrifice, that's all. But it's like the Lord is speaking to our hearts. It's like the Lord is pleading with us. It's like there has to be a shift in our spirit. Before there can be a shift in the physical and in the carnal, there has to be a shift in the spirit.
Yes.
And if we don't allow God to shift our spirits this morning, how are we going to move into that place of everlasting? How are we going to move into that realm of the spirit? And even begin, because the Bible says that those that don't have the spirit of God don't understand the things of the spirit. That's why when people don't allow the anointing of God in their lives, and they don't allow the dew of heaven over their lives, you know what begins to happen? They get bored. They get switched off. They get turned off because they're thinking to themselves, what am I doing here? All this stuff about seed and sowing and dew and what is all this? I'm telling you, this is the language of heaven, because God wants you and I to be immersed in the glory. God, that's why God, Jesus spoke in parables, because people didn't get it. I want to be a person that doesn't get it. I want to get the message. I want to understand that I need the Spirit of God to be evident in my life, that I cannot be salt and light without the reality of the power of God living in me, without the fire of God being ignited in me, and without the presence of God bringing the glory of God upon me. Amen.
We hope you have been blessed by this message. Join Pastor Deborah next week for another exciting word.